We noted that one result of the Earth's rotation on its axis was daily alternation between daylight and darkness. As you know, one day equals the time it takes for one rotation of the Earth. The day is a natural unit of time. Hours, minutes, and seconds are human creation. We take time for granted. It's always literally at our fingertips, on our computer screen, or on our cell phone, or if you're a bit old school, it's on your wristwatch. However, if you just go back a few generations, household clocks and personal watches were not common. Clocks began to be mass-produced in the 1860s, and wristwatches came into common use only after their use by the military in World War I. So what did folks do prior to the mass production of clocks? Generally, cities and even small villages had a clock tower set to local solar noon. So every town or village used its own local solar time. Local solar noon is the time when the sun is highest in the sky. This can be easily determined by simply noticing when objects cast their shortest shadow. Notably, solar noon does not mean the sun is directly overhead, coming in at 90 degrees. In much of the world, latitudes greater than 23.5 degrees, the sun never rises that high in the sky. Rather, solar noon simply means the sun is at the highest point in the sky that it's going to get for that particular location. How high it gets in the sky depends on latitude. Using solar time, each village could set its clock tower to the local solar noon, and the whole community would use this time. This worked for centuries. Interestingly, though, local solar time means that every village would have its own time. Local solar noon depends on the longitude. The Earth rotates once, 360 degrees, in 24 hours. Thus, 15 degrees every hour. And that means 1 degree every 4 minutes. So two towns that were 1 degree apart in longitude would experience solar noon at different times, 4 minutes apart. This was no big deal until information and people began to travel faster via telegraphs and railroads. These faster forms of travel spurred the development of a standardized time system. A standardized time system was developed in 1884 at the same conference where the prime meridian was chosen as the zero for longitude. The system is quite simple. The world is divided into 24 standard time zones, one for each hour of the day. Since a circle is 360 degrees, each of the 24 time zones encompasses 15 degrees of longitude. The prime meridian is the center for one time zone, originally called Greenwich Mean Time, but now referred to as Coordinated Universal Time, UTC. This time zone is centered on the prime meridian and extends 7.5 degrees to the east and 7.5 degrees to the west, for a total of 15 degrees. Every 15 degrees around the Earth, there's another central meridian for another time zone. Theoretically, each of these time zones would be 15 degrees wide, and the boundaries would run straight up and down the map. You can see the only place this really holds true to any extent is the oceans, where there's no countries. When we encounter political boundaries, the map doesn't even nearly resemble a 15-degree spacing any longer. Consider China. By its geography, it encompasses at least four time zones. But they've decided to have the whole country in one time zone. So 6 a.m. to the eastern part of the country is going to look a lot different in terms of daylight than 6 a.m. over here on the western edge of the country. So some countries or states have chosen to put their whole state within one time zone. Texas has done this in the United States. But sometimes it's physical boundaries that end up helping to figure out where the time zones would logically lie. For example, in Idaho, the Salmon River meanders all throughout the state and was a pretty insurmountable barrier for much of Idaho's early history. Thus, the northern part of Idaho as does more commerce with Washington and eastern Oregon, and maintained their status in the Pacific time zone, whereas the southern part of Oregon tended to do more business with Wyoming and Montana and maintained that it should be in the Mountain Standard time zone. So both physical boundaries and political boundaries can play a role in determining where the actual time zone lines meander. Okay, so how do time zones work? Each entire time zone uses the local solar time for the central meridian of that zone. And remember that these central meridians are spaced about every 15 degrees, starting with the prime meridian. So for example, Redwood City is located in the Pacific Standard Time Zone, and the central meridian is more or less where Lake Tahoe is in longitude. So that's the solar time that's used for the whole entire time zone. If you were traveling and crossed a time zone, as you travel east, you would need to add an hour to your clock. Because as the Earth is turned towards the east, they're ahead of us when it comes to time. Similarly, if you were traveling west and crossed a time zone, you would subtract an hour from your time. So you add an hour when you go east, and you subtract an hour when you go west. Let's try a few simple problems. If it's 11 a.m. on Monday in San Francisco, what time and day is it in New York City? Well, we'll just have to count time zones. And when we do so, we should always use the clocks at the top so that we don't miss any time zones. So if it's 11 a.m. in San Francisco, it'd be an hour later in the Rocky Mountain time zone. So it'd be noon, then it'd be 1, and here in the blue where New York is, it would be 2 p.m. It's 3 hours later. Similarly, if it's 11 a.m. in San Francisco, what time is it over here in Paris? Paris is here, San Francisco here. So 11 a.m., noon, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 p.m. in Paris. As a final example, let's think about if it's 11 a.m. Monday in San Francisco, what time it might be in Beijing. Well, 11 a.m., noon, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 p.m., midnight. Now we're going to the next day, 1 o'clock Tuesday morning, 2 o'clock Tuesday morning, 3 o'clock Tuesday morning. I give you some problems like this on this week's assignment. And when you're doing them, make sure that you're counting along the top part of this map and not trying to do it right directly on the map, because you may miss some time zones. In the case of China here, remember, right, you might have missed this time zone here. Anyway, I encourage you to practice calculating time zones. Also in our discussion of time zones, we need to address the international dateline. The time zones that we discussed previously give us a system for changing hours of the day around the world. However, we still need a rule for changing days. The international dateline has been established to resolve this issue. The international dateline is located theoretically on the 180 meridian, exactly on the opposite side of the world from the prime meridian. However, you can see on the diagram that it weaves a bit to the east and west occasionally to ensure that island groups are all on the same day. Notably, the dateline is in the middle of a time zone. So when you cross the international dateline, you do not change time, but you do change date. When you cross from east to west, you advance one day. When you cross from west to east, you go back one day. Perhaps that'd be a pretty cool thing to do on your birthday. Start your birthday over here, and then when your birthday's over, cross over here to Alaska and have it all over again. Let's practice using the international dateline, doing the same calculations we did earlier. If it's 11 a.m. in San Francisco, and we wanted to know what time it was in Beijing, One way we could do it is what we did before and count this direction around the world. We could go the other way as well, and we should get the same answer. So it's 11 a.m., 10 a.m., 9 a.m., 8 a.m., 7 a.m. Whoops, crossed the date line. Now I got to go to 7 a.m. Tuesday, 6 a.m. Tuesday, 5 a.m., 4 a.m., 3 a.m. Tuesday, which is the same answer we got when we went the other way around the world. So when I give you time zone problems, I encourage you to check your answers by calculating them going both directions. The main thing to remember, though, is that when you cross the international date line, you change date, but you do not change time, because the date line is in the middle of a time zone. The last topic we'll address related to time is daylight savings time. Your book notes that it was first adopted by Germany during the First World War to save energy. Since then, many other nations have adopted daylight savings time as well. The United States established daylight savings time in 1966 and then expanded it, effective 2007, in the Energy Policy Act of 2005. Thus, in the springtime, we now spring forward to daylight savings time by advancing our clocks 1 hour on the second Sunday of March. And in the fall, we fall back to standard time by moving our clocks back 1 hour on the first Sunday of November. Indeed, we are in daylight savings time nearly 7 months of the year. Notably, Russia is on daylight savings time all year round. And tropical nations don't bother with daylight savings time, as their day length does not change much throughout the year. In the United States, I believe Arizona and Hawaii are the only two states that also don't use daylight savings time. Later in the lesson, we'll see why nations closer to the equator have day lengths all about the same time all throughout the year, and thus daylight savings doesn't really make sense for them to use. As noted previously, one of the major reasons for enacting daylight savings time is to save energy due to lighting in the evenings when we're all still up. Notably, though, as we move away from inefficient incandescent light bulbs to more energy-efficient LEDs, the energy savings will likely decline. I wonder if that will make it less likely for states and countries to use daylight savings time. Who knows?